Healthcare is changing, and Dr. Nancy RN is here for you. The topics are many, but each program stands on its own with three key action points for you to learn. Your guide to a healthier you in a changing world. Dr. Nancy RN.
Welcome to Dr. Nancy RN, Healthy You, Healthy Nation, Healthy World. I'm Nancy Valentine, PhD and registered nurse, and this show is really for you, the healthcare consumer. We want you to be knowledgeable and feeling really powerful in navigating the healthcare system. Today we have a very interesting topic that I think you will find very illuminating in terms of what's going on in healthcare today. The title of our show today is Moral Courage, An Antidote to Moral Distress. And this is a guide for healthcare professionals. And we are having our guest today is Dr. Vicki Lockman, and I'm going to tell you a bit about her. Vicki Lockman is a professor and teaches ethics at Drexel University College of Nursing. She completed her baccalaureate degree and her master's degree at the University of Pennsylvania and is a psychiatric nurse who has majored in ethics. She then got a Temple University doctoral degree, then going on for further ethics work in bioethics from the University of Pennsylvania as well. She has really a very exemplary career and has done a lot nationally and internationally in this whole area of ethics. And much of her work is really focused on the training of healthcare professionals, and we're going to tell you about what that entails. She has authored over 100 publications, and she has many books to her credit. The last one is The Ethical Challenges in Healthcare, Developing Your Moral Compass, and she has written this to help healthcare professionals to be more active and engaged in working with patients. And I think that one of the reasons we wanted Vicki to come and speak with us about this topic today is because what is happening in healthcare is we're trying to increase and help healthcare professionals be more effective in their communication with you, the consumer, you, the individual, the family, the community. But what Vicki is going to tell us about today is this takes a lot of training and retraining. Because when people come out of nursing programs or medical programs, they often are really not prepared for some of the real life situations that they encounter as clinicians. And often you as the consumer can be looking at them and wondering why they are not listening to you, or they do seem preoccupied, or they're not really very good communicators in general. And I think Vicki's work, which has been groundbreaking, she has received many awards for her work, has really been trying to crack the code on helping everyone to be more effective in their communication with you, and really to understand how that's a huge and important thread through their practice, no matter what their professional background may be. So with that opening, I want to thank you, Vicki, for being with us and welcome you to this discussion, because these are big terms, you know, moral distress, moral courage. I think it would be very helpful for our listeners if you could define some of these terms and then walk us through your work, which you've been doing for many years now, and you've made a tremendous impact.
I got involved in this work because I was experiencing so many people talking to me about moral distress. And it was whether I was talking to the CEO of a hospital who was having to contemplate closing maternity services because you can't make money in maternity in this country, or I was talking to the frontline staff nurse who was taking care of a patient that she or he felt was torturing in an ICU. So I was tired of really only talking about the problem. So I started to investigate what were some of the solutions here. Because when one starts to experience moral distress, one of the things that can happen is the decreased communication with patients. Because the person's trying to manage their own stress in the situation. And so they could be pulling away from family members or pulling away from patients, and it was making the communication worse.
Well, that's understandable, because when you're in any difficult communication circumstance, your natural tendency is withdraw or to flee rather than to confront it. So you are really saying we've got to confront this.
We've got to confront this. And so the way in which I, in my investigation and research, it seemed to me that if moral distress is knowing what the right thing to do and not doing it, then moral courage would be knowing what the right thing to do is and doing it, mm-hmm. even though all the forces around you may not want you to do that. So it's, you feel the fear and you speak up anyway. And so it might be that in an intensive care unit, the advance directive that the patient has is not being honored, and the nurse sees that it's not being honored, and the consumer is not able to speak up. And so it's the nurse's obligation to step in and to speak, help the individual speak up, or to speak up and say, wait a minute here, this is not what this patient wants, and that's really clear right here in this document. And so it really was around finding ways to help the nurses have a voice, and sometimes it's the medical students, because it might be their chief resident that's wanting them to do something that the medical student doesn't want to do,
right.
or the resident.
I think it would be really good to step back and realize that, you know, of all the industries out there, healthcare is probably filled with more moral distress than almost anything else that I can think of. How about, what's your thought on that?
I would think probably the only one that might come a close second is education.
Mm-hmm.
Because of all this teach to the test scores that's going on in our public schools. So at least my teacher friends have some of that too.
So they talk about how distressed they are.
Because again, they don't feel like they're doing the right thing mm-hmm. for the students.
Right.
And when you feel like you know what's the right thing to do, and you don't feel that you can do the right thing, that's what causes the moral distress.
Right. So again, in sort of trying to tease out the factors that contribute to this, it seems like then whether you're talking about healthcare or, as you said, teaching, you're dealing with a certain small number of professionals, a lot of people, consumers, mm-hmm. that you're dealing with.
Mm-hmm.
And you're also dealing with certain policies, certain procedures, certain expectations that really can get in the way of mm-hmm. what you as the individual practitioner thinks mm-hmm. is the best thing for this patient at this particular time. So mm-hmm. we're really living in environments that are just fraught with a lot of conflict. That mm-hmm. doesn't mean that it can't be dealt with, but I think that's really the purpose of our discussion today, mm-hmm. is really to talk about how we're trying to help people who are very talented, very intelligent, but maybe not the best communicators mm-hmm. because these are not easy things to communicate or to talk about.
Mm-hmm.
So tell us, you know, how you first then got interested. You said, I want to do something about this, and you decided that moral courage was really mm-hmm. was the more positive way of dealing with this rather than just keep hammering away at the distress. You know,
yeah.
the distress is there, we know it. And then you wanted to do something with moral courage. So knowing that you had that framework to work from, what did you do?
Well, what I did is that I began to look at what were the kinds of situations that healthcare professionals had the most difficulty in communicating mm-hmm. effectively. And what I found was that it basically was in around the end of life issues.
Mm-hmm.
And what I call it's when you have to deliver bad news. Okay, those are the most difficult times. And whether it's the initial diagnosis of cancer or the somewhere along the continuum that your child's asthma isn't going to, looks like it's getting worse, or your husband doesn't qualify for a transplant. So it's when the consumer is on the receiving end of that bad news, how do you deliver that news in the most compassionate, direct, specific way that you can? Because you want to do it in a caring way, but you also want the consumer to know the truth. And sometimes I've seen information delivered by people that the person has no idea what they just said.
Right.
They don't know the severity of the illness. And if you don't know the severity of your prognosis or your illness, then you might not be making the right decisions. It might be better for you to go on that cruise rather than to stay home and take that second round of chemotherapy.
Right. So when you started outlining, you know, your thesis on this, so to speak, did you find that people really were sort of clueless about this in general. Not everyone. I mean, obviously, mm-hmm. there were exemplary stars out there that just sort of naturally knew how mm-hmm. to do this. But did you find that most people just did not receive this in their training? I mean, where were the gaps?
Yes. Well, the gaps start with the training. There, in most medical schools and nursing schools now, there is some communication training. And in medical school, actually to get out of medical school now, they have this thing called OSCEs, which is where they work with people who are patients. And they one of the things they have to do is deliver bad news to graduate from medical school now.
You mean, are these people actors or are they real patients?
Yeah, these are actors that act. They have scripted patients. A lot of medical schools and nursing schools are using this now as a kind of simulation.
Okay.
As I began to look at that, I began to notice that some people really didn't even know it was their obligation to do some of these things.
Interesting.
Part of the obligation, and it's both in the medical code as well as in the nursing code of ethics, is there is an obligation to make sure, and there's a whole list of things that the patient is to be told to have informed consent, right? And too many nurses thought all their job was to witness the informed consent form. No, according to that code of ethics, the nurse's responsibility is to make sure that the patient understands and comprehends the information, mm-hmm. that they know the risks and benefits, they know other options, and sometimes that's not done. And sometimes it's the consumer says, look, doc, you make the decision, it's okay, I don't need to know all this information. Mm-hmm. Well, the consumer has a right not to have all that information, but they also have a right to have that information.
Right. And everyone's different.
Yes.
You know, in that
case. Yes.
So, I mean, part of why they may have been clueless that this was part of their obligation is they hadn't seen it role modeled.
Mm-hmm.
Because, mm-hmm. I mean, so much of clinical training is not just, you know, sitting in classrooms or simulation labs, but it's really watching the senior people. And they have to be exemplary if you're going to turn out to be exemplary too. Mm-hmm. They have to really sort of train you and mentor you into these. And so you weren't seeing that enough of that happening either.
And you're really right on that, Nancy, because the people that I saw were exemplary. And I would ask them, how did you learn to be so good at this? I want to clone you, okay? And they'd say, it was my chief resident, or it was my attending. Okay. Mm-hmm. Or it was my nurse manager, or it was, so they saw it
right.
being done
right.
the right way.
Right.
That was so common, it became the norm mm-hmm. to me. And mm-hmm. so that they were learning through the role modeling. And so if they didn't have the role modeling, then we had to come up with a plan, educational plan.
Right, there are not enough role models to go around, obviously. We wouldn't have the problem to begin with. But I think you did some groundbreaking work in this too to really add to this framework, and you mm-hmm. came up with some real structure on how to train people because mm-hmm. they're not going to learn it from hands-on help mm-hmm. in lots of cases. They're going to learn it either in these simulation situations or they're going to learn it in a lecture, you know, things mm-hmm. that you do actually as an educator. So tell us about what you came up with to help people really deal with this.
So let me start you with the model that I came up with to try and help healthcare professionals remember. And so I came up with the acronym CODE. C is for courage, O is for your obligations, D is for danger management, and then the E is the actual expression. So let's go back to the C for the courage. Really defining courage. And part of the way that I would do this would be through case studies. Healthcare professionals learn through cases.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Yeah, the consumer, I'm sorry, you are seen as a case sometimes. And
well, tell us what a case study entails. Not everybody will know what a case study is.
A case study might be a 55-year-old African-American man arrives in your ICU with a below-the-knee amputation, okay, has diabetes, congestive heart failure, all the diagnoses, and is now actually had a cardiac arrest in the emergency room and is now on a ventilator. He has the family refuses to come to the hospital and there is a brother-in-law who is willing to come in. And so I outline
right.
what the case.
It's a sample of mm-hmm. a real life scenario, and cases then are used for people to then have to problem solve and mm-hmm. and do critical thinking to figure out what's your first step, what's your second step, you know, mm-hmm. and so you have to really work through the case in order to come to a conclusion, hopefully a good one.
Right. And so the first question becomes is, what is your obligations in this case? And I help them track the obligation to their code of ethics. What page did that come on? What does the code of ethics say about confidentiality in this situation? When do you break confidentiality? When do you, you know, there are situations where you would break confidentiality with a patient. What might that be? So we would actually help them understand what their ethical obligations are. Because if I know it's an obligation, if I know it's a duty as a nurse or as a physician, then it's going to be easier to do.
Well, let's talk about a case. So let's walk through a case. So as we've defined a case as a usual circumstance where a student can listen to, you know, a regular real life scenario, then what? Mm-hmm. What do you do with the case?
Well, then what we do is we go to the O and we look at what are the ethical obligations that this individual has in this particular case. So in the one that I was talking about, there is an ethical obligation to make sure that there is somebody who can make the decisions for that patient, mm-hmm. Who knows that patient as best they can. Otherwise, we have to move to what would be the best interest standard. The best interest standard is we have no idea what this individual would have wanted, but what is in the best interests of this patient?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So in that particular situation, I would throw some other things in that might add a little conflict to the situation, because the D for danger management, we have to create a situation where it might be dangerous to speak up in that particular situation. So in that case, there was a disagreement between the attending and the resident as to what should be done for this particular individual.
And that's a power shift. You know, mm-hmm. because it's really difficult for these younger students to really speak up to some of their senior people.
Mm-hmm.
So you were helping them to figure out how to do that.
Yes. And so and part of the danger management is to, first of all, get yourself calmed down. Because by definition, moral courage, you have to speak up despite your fear. So you're going to feel fear. Mm-hmm. And how can you quell fear? Well, the fastest and simplest way to do that is to take some deep breaths. Because mm-hmm. You cannot deep breathe and be anxious at the same time. It really quells the stress that you have. Then what you do is to calm your mind, because when you're under stress, your amygdala, your little limbic reptilian brain is in charge back there. And so what you want to do is get your frontal cortex that has all of the decision-making, executive function, back in gear. And the easiest way to do that is what we have this thing called cognitive reframing. Now, what does that mean? That means that I have a voice in my head that's constantly going on. We're constantly talking to ourselves. That was a good idea. That was a bad idea. Why did you say that? Why didn't you say this? You know, this little voice has a running commentary, but when it's negative, oh my God, they'll fire me if I speak up. Okay. Or this person will make my life miserable if, in fact, I speak up. Or if I speak up, my peers will give me a problem. Then, if I'm saying that, it's going to be mm-hmm. very hard.
Mm-hmm. And that's very common. I mean, I think that playback in people's minds is often very negative around a lot of things.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I always say, if you don't... to change what you're thinking is going to change how you feel.
Right. And how you act.
You know, many of you have heard about cognitive behavioral therapy. Cognitive behavioral therapy is changing how you think or changing how you act. And we know it works.
Mm-hmm.
And so that cognitive reframing, changing the story, you know, we make up a story about what's going to happen.
Mm-hmm.
And if we make up a negative story, then it's harder to take the risk. So part of it is also helping people be better risk takers.
So when you would be talking to medical students or to nursing students or any professional person, were they able to really talk about their fears? I mean, was it very hard for them to talk about their fears, or were they really sort of relieved that somebody was helping them to articulate their fears?
More the latter, more relieved. It's like, this person's not going to pretend that this stuff is all okay and that we shouldn't be afraid. Even when I'm teaching students online, you know, this week is the week they're to talk about their skills that they need to learn to have a better level of moral courage. Mm-hmm. And I am always struck by the level of honesty, whether it's in class or online, that people have. Good, I get a chance to talk about this. Mm-hmm. You know, that was such, and these people are remembering situations that happened many, many years, some 17 years ago this happened, 20 years, and they're still carrying it around because they didn't have the courage to speak up.
And so they feel maybe guilty.
Yes, that ashamed, guilty. Mm-hmm. So part of it is helping them take the risks and really asking themselves, what is the worst case scenario here?
Right.
The doctor can't fire you, okay? So what is the worst case scenario here? Can you deal with the consequences of the situation, mm-hmm. of what really might happen in this?
And then you get to the E.
And then we get to the E, yep. And that's the skill training. And that's where we actually do role playing. So we'll have a case, okay, and we'd have multiple, I get what I call little scenarios cases, so they're smaller. The surgeon doesn't adequately explain the surgery to a patient. What are your obligations? How might you say what you're going to say? Right? Or they've made this patient, they're no longer going to treat this patient, they've moved this patient to palliative care or comfort care, okay, and the resident has ordered a blood study on this patient, what will you do? Because you don't do studies on individuals that have been moved to comfort care. That's an intervention. So what would be your obligation in that, and how would you say it? Mm-hmm. So we practice with words. And then we also, not just the initial statement, but what happens if they get defensive? What happens if they start to cry? What happens if they walk away from you? Mm-hmm. So all the kinds of situations that nurses or physicians, I also teach physician assistants, might confront.
Mm-hmm. it's a real drama out there. You know, mm-hmm. I mean, I think that what is really very interesting about what Vicki is telling us about today is that we tend, it's only natural, if you're a patient or a family member, you're very focused on yourself, as you should be. And you're very concerned about your thoughts and feelings and what you're trying to negotiate in a situation. But what you're really telling us about is there's drama inside of all these different people that you're encountering that you tend to think are very knowledgeable and very capable and very much in control. But they are also swimming upstream in some cases where they really feel that something should be done. There's maybe a policy, a procedure, a person that is blocking that. And I think what we're talking about is how do they resolve that stress? Mm-hmm. Is it always resolvable? Maybe sometimes it is and maybe sometimes it isn't. Mm-hmm. There are realities in certain situations that really just mitigate against, even if you did speak up, that's not necessarily going to change it. Mm-hmm. But what I do hear you saying is that by really addressing this with healthcare professionals, they are going to take that step regardless. And they're going to really practice more advocacy. They're going to be more at ease with, you know, taking on these dilemmas, and really figuring out some pathway to a better outcome than just making assumptions. Is that really what you're
yes, that's what my hope is, and that's what the feedback I get is, because it'll make it safer for the consumer. It'll make it safe, because if a nurse will, in fact, say, doctor, I'm sorry, you have to stop putting in that central line right now because you just contaminated the field, okay? That will save that consumer a potential infection in a hospital.
Right.
And it's interesting, we're in week four now in class, and by week, it's usually about week seven, I start getting these emails. Dr. Lockman, you would not believe what I had the courage to do today.
Okay. So they're reporting their success stories.
They're reporting and they report that when things didn't work, and then we have to talk about why that didn't work. And
right.
Because you're also right, Nancy, that some organizations, it's not safe to speak up. And that's part of what nursing leaders have to do and medical leaders have to do, is to make an environment that provides where moral courage isn't necessary.
Right, right, right. I think a lot of that work is being done in magnet hospitals. Magnet Hospital Program for Excellence really does emphasize, among many other aspects, healthy work environments. And healthy work environments are really for everyone that works in that environment. It's not only for nurses, it's not only for physicians, it's really for everyone. Mm-hmm. And the whole piece of that that is really relevant to this conversation is that communication and being able to speak up. And would you say things are changing? I mean, in terms of this education, you're obviously educating people mm-hmm. at Drexel. University of Pennsylvania is renowned for their work in bioethics. I mean, there are some real exemplars out there, but even in general, in organizations throughout the United States, mm-hmm. do you see that there's a real trend to move in this direction?
I do, and I do because of patient safety.
Mm-hmm.
And the patient safety is driving it, and now Medicare is driving it, because now Medicare has some pay for performance programs around patient satisfaction.
Right.
So the hospitals will be paid more if, in fact, they have higher patient satisfaction and patient quality. And so I think between those are main drivers. To get these changes in place.
What I think is really very interesting about that is it's external pressure. There is a lot of work being done to improve quality in hospitals throughout the country. And as Vicki just said, that's really very much tied to reimbursement. Because of that, people have analyzed that many mistakes are made because of communication errors. Mm-hmm. The fact that people did not speak up, now they're being required to speak up. So it's not even a question of should I or shouldn't I. It's almost now going to a whole other level of consciousness raising.
Absolutely.
That you will be chastised if you don't speak up, because mm-hmm. you will then have been party to an error.
Yes, and the codes both say that if you condone through silence, you are just as guilty as the person who actually
right.
did it. I mean, we don't go forward with surgery in an operating room until we take that time out and
right.
we make sure we got the right patient in the right room with the right marking on their leg
right.
so that we don't have any wrong side errors.
But what's really interesting dynamically in terms of organizational change that's going on is that the code of ethics for nursing has been there for many, many years. The code mm-hmm. of ethics for physicians, very similar. They've been there for many years, but there wasn't this wholesale action, wholesale
skill
plan
training.
And
right.
skill training, exactly. To go along with it, to really help people, was more like, these are the codes of ethics and, you know, have a nice day.
Mm-hmm.
Now they're really being forced to be put in place, as they should be.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
But that took external pressure tied to finance.
Mm-hmm.
Interesting.
Yeah, no, I just did a presentation last week at a magnet hospital, and it was called Translating the Code of Ethics into Clinical Practice.
Very nice.
Yeah, because it's helping nurses to, this is what the code says, so what would that look like in practice here? What would be your obligations to do based upon?
Right, right. Well, I think I feel very comforted to know that Vicki Lockman mm-hmm. is teaching people that are going to be taking care of me and my family someday, as well as you and your families. Thank you for being with us, but I really also want to thank you for having the courage so early on in your career to really take on a problem which at that mm-hmm. time was not exactly the sexiest thing or the most popular, and really developing mm-hmm. this and really taking years to really get that message out to so many people, writing books, authoring publications, speaking around the world. You've really been a tremendous trailblazer, and I want to thank you for being with us. It was a pleasure to have you as part of our team here. Thank you very much, and thank you for watching our show. Have a wonderful day.
I hope you enjoyed our conversation today and that the information will help you in meeting your health goals.
Catch this program and other conversations on the website, drnancyrn.com. Or you can write to me as well. I welcome your comments and feedback. Thank you for listening and join us again. And remember, with health, all things are possible.